I'm Sarah Jensen, editor of OEM Off-Highway, and today I'm speaking with Kevin Rhodes, Chief Engineer of Electrification. Thank you for speaking with me today. So maybe if you could just sort of start with talking about some of the key trends the company is seeing regarding electrification and heavy-duty equipment.
Absolutely. Well, electrification in general is a big deal at AVL, and I think across really the automotive and just the whole industry altogether. We're seeing a lot of interest anywhere from small mobility applications all the way up to heavy-duty off-road trucks and mining and Class 8 trucks. There's a lot of activity in the space of electrification for, you know, a multitude of reasons. Specifically to the area of heavy-duty equipment, see activity in, as I was mentioning, shipping, in mining, off-road vehicles, and military applications. There's a lot of stuff there. Some of the biggest trends we see in terms of engineering around those applications are e-axle development. So there's a lot of, especially in shipping and things like that, being able to take large existing fleets and do retrofits of e-axles that can just drop right in there and give you all of the benefits of regenerative braking or hybridization, like a through-the-road hybrid or more advanced systems that maybe can utilize and get some of the benefits of electrification that way. A lot of interest there because of the simplicity of dropping that in and getting a lot of bang for your buck in that approach. It's really attractive for the small packaging, the high system efficiency that goes along with that, as well as the relatively low system weight and cost of outfitting a fleet for that. Then we also see interest in the 48-volt system. So, you know, taking a step back from where the high voltage might be, 48-volt has a lot of benefits to it as well. We see a lot of applications that are going to use higher voltage, kind of straddle the fence and going with a dedicated 48-volt line in addition to their existing high voltage and their 12-volt lines. Being able to step down to that level gives you additional efficiencies that you might not gain for some medium power applications. Examples of those might be communication systems, lighting, auxiliary pumps, you know, for water pumps, oil pumps, coolant pumps, as well as things like AC, you know, in trucking where you maybe pull over and need to condition the system overnight or, you know, have auxiliary power. 48-volt systems is a very good solution there. And we, of course, see 48-volt even has applications for traction, being able to provide. We have in AVL some e-axle applications that are based around 48-volt systems. So there's really a lot of flexibility there and interest in that one. And then also, going to again to the other side of that spectrum is high voltage battery applications. So we see a lot of interest in, especially at higher powers, going and looking at something like the 800 volt to 1000 volt systems. And that way, you know, you can get around some of the higher currents that might be needed to provide the necessary power for those larger applications by going to that higher voltage, downsize some of your electrical distribution system and your cabling, save cost and weight there, package space, of course. And also just the design of those batteries needs to be taken into account to account for the ruggedization that's necessary for off-road and industrial applications, making sure that they have all the safety they need. And, you know, special considerations like vibration and shock, as well as for the large battery systems that would be needed to give the kind of energy for these large applications. Sometimes it's necessary to break those packs up into separate sub-packs to allow for, you know, not a single pack, which would be any kind of flexure in that due to takeoff or deceleration could lead to degradation of the welds or the connections inside of there. So looking at special designs for high voltage systems to kind of make it modular and break them up to address some of those special needs.
And are there any specific types of components or systems AVL is focusing its electrification design efforts on? Or are you guys kind of looking at the gamut of whatever manufacturers or OEMs are looking for? Or?
Well, so AVL as a whole, we've got a long history of powertrain development, so about 70 years in conventional. You know, our goal for 2025, we're on path to do this, is to make a third of our overall work and our revenues to be based on electrification, and then a third on conventional, and then a third on autonomous. Of course, autonomous and electrification are very linked for a lot of reasons. So we do a lot in, you know, not only classifications, as I mentioned, from small applications to large. In terms of the components we work on everything from power electronics and control systems. So that would be like your inverter, your DC-DC, your control systems, all the software, and then your charging systems, as well as driveline systems. So as I mentioned, e-axles, e-motors, 48-volt mild hybrid systems, things like that. Drives and actuators with the actual, well, I mentioned e-motors, but auxiliary pumps and things, design and development of motors, and energy storage, of course. So batteries is a huge thing. But we also work a lot in fuel cells as well, which is, you know, tied very intimately with that. And that falls under electrification for us. But we don't just do component design. We also have experts all over the world. You know, we're a global company looking at simulation, benchmarking of all of, you know, industrial machinery, passenger car, everything in between, as well as doing functional safety, hardware design, software design, and, you know, really anything that would fit between concept all the way up to start of production. The only place we don't really normally play is in manufacturing. But that's where we leverage a lot of our resources and partnerships to come up with, you know, manufacturing partners as necessary for our customers.
And are there any challenges associated with developing electric vehicle components and systems you guys are seeing, and what might be some ways of overcoming those challenges?
Absolutely. You know, electrification is a very nice in many respects that there's maybe not as many moving parts as you might have or as many components, but there's definitely challenges associated with going from a whole industry that's based around an internal combustion system into something that's based around electrification. Mm-hmm. As you might imagine, a lot of the people who have whole careers and expertise built up, and there's a lot that we can transfer from that within conventional OEMs or new players here, they have a lot of expertise, but it's not necessarily focused in operating in high voltage or in the type of control systems and algorithms that are necessary for implementing these type of systems. So, you know, we fill a niche in that aspect for coming in and being able to support with the expertise we do have there, both in training as well as development and engineering support. This area starts to grow and becomes, you know, bigger, and people, everyone's jumping on because just electrification has so many benefits to it beyond just, you know, the obvious efficiencies and emissions, but costs and other things over the long term, they're going to be taken into account. So expertise is one. I think that we fill a niche there. Cell availability is one of the key aspects, though, I see in terms of challenges to implementing a system. So being able to get a hold of these cells right now can be a challenge depending on the volume you're looking at. And we see that a lot, and we do consult with that in terms of cell selection, cell availability, you know, applications, be it a prototype or something that doesn't want to go into, you know, a full-scale production line type of application. Cylindrical cells like 18650s or 21700 type cells are an excellent option because they're available and they're commoditized for the electronics industry. They do excellent performance, you know, and they could be designed well there. But that is one, if you wanted to get into more aggressive chemistries or more, you know, like prismatic and pouch cells, there can be challenges because you need to work out a partnership with the cell supplier. And we can assist with that as well. We have contacts and we have a lot of expertise there. But that's one area. The other area, I think, would be that it's a rapidly advancing area. There's a lot of changes going on with it. Even in the, you know, I guess about 15 years I've been working specifically in this since I got my doctorate, we've seen massive changes in what are the power levels we're working with here. 5, 10 years ago, 50 kilowatts is going to be a big charger for a passenger car. And now, you know, you see 150, you see up to 400 kilowatt stations that, you know, can distribute power. It's rapidly advancing just because of the availability and the rapidly decreasing cost of some of these components. I think the last one I want to point out, probably, global regulations. So regulations are a huge issue when you're trying to design, you know, a commercial application and you want to make it global. We have a bit of an advantage because we do have expertise both in China and Europe in the United States. Those are rapidly advancing, and it depends on a lot of things that, you know, nobody can really directly control. Geopolitical climates, the pandemic itself could have a major impact on, you know, how people push forward with what the regulations or incentives are there. In order to be a competitor in this space, you really have to have a grasp on what those regulations are so that you're not surprised later on, how to do the proper testing. And, you know, I think we can support a lot of that. That's definitely a challenging area, though.
How do you foresee electrification progressing in the coming years? It seems like it's just going to continue advancing. Is it going to keep going to higher power levels? Is there certain types of power systems which might overtake others? Do you have any thoughts on that?
If I had all the right answers, I would be playing the stock market and I wouldn't have to work. But I would tell you that from what I can see, it's very diverse and there's a lot of things that are going to happen. As I mentioned, because of the diversity of regional regulations and things like that, there's some changes there. But overall, I'd say what we're going to see is a trend towards cost reduction. We're going to see a lot more normalization of electrification. A lot of the components are going to be driven towards a commodity item. And I think that's important because right now, a lot of things have to be custom made. There's a lot of applications that, you know, you have a specific need for your fleet. You want to design a custom solution. And a lot of times there's nothing available to pull off the shelf. But a lot of components, for example, DC-DCs or chargers or DC to AC modules or like inverters, I think we'll see a lot of those becoming standardized as people kind of normalize what the power levels are and what the usage cases are. I think we're going to see a lot more of that. That's going to drive down cost through volume. And I think you'll be able to see something similar happening in the region of batteries, which of course is a huge cost driver for the overall system. The chemistries are advancing. You know, there's always a next step of chemistry to come along. And there's a lot of things to look forward to advancing that. And they've steadily progressed in reducing that cost. And I think that as new manufacturers come online, there's talks about things happening in Europe and the United States and other things like that. We're going to see competition in that region. We're going to see the prices continue to come down. And I think right now is really a great time to get into that space because it's just going to continue moving very rapidly. And if you're not getting on board with it right now as a company, you're going to be left behind to some extent. And you really need to at least be advancing your knowledge of that and be ready for the changes that are going to be coming in the next, you know, 5, 10, 20 years. Mm-hmm. Specific systems, you know, we could talk about, is it going to be lithium ion batteries that do this? Will there be some new chemistry? Is it going to be fuel cell based? You see a lot of different companies looking at, you know, how does that interplay between fuel cells and batteries happen? Mm-hmm. I think that's going to be a very interesting space to look at in the future. I don't know how that's all going to play out. It comes into a lot of things with fuel cells being driven by, you know, different metals and things that are available, as well as similarly in batteries, you know. So we'll see a lot of competition there. But I think there's some interesting companies that we've seen coming onto the market that are at least taking risks and really pushing forward. And a lot's going to come out of, you know, how do they fare and does the infrastructure develop along with it? So, you know, there's a lot of things to be looking forward to.
Thank you so much for providing your insights today.
Absolutely. Very happy to do it.